Hello, and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host, Brian. We're going to wrap up today with a special selection, which is where one of you tell me exactly what it is I need to check out. Today's special selection comes at us from ProgPair. Been a while since we've had Pain of Salvation on the channel. I'm really curious about your thoughts on one of my favorites by them, People Passing By, off of their 97 debut, Entropia. So that's what we're going to be checking out. Look at some of Pain of Salvation's debut music. See what's going on with them today. Oh yeah, real funky bass. Yeah, so 3 bars of 4 and a bar of 3. So every other time is a bar of 3. So this one should be it. Nope, that's 4. So it's just the intro then. Nice vocal harmony. Playing around a lot with time. Actually, the last section was alternating 4 and 5, I believe. Really strong bass presence here. Such a stark transition there. Really cool layering the vocals on top of the 16th note picking. There's a lot of driving intensity throughout this track, usually contrasted with tense eeriness. And then these rare moments of calm. It's really interesting listening to all the dynamic qualities in this track. Everybody's has multiple skill sets on their instrument. It's fascinating. Groove is so good. Yeah, Interesting movement. Real quick, like a 5'8". Or double time 5'4". I really like that drum pattern. I don't know what time signatures we're in, but I feel like we're doing 21 eighth notes per phrase.
Once he was strong and filled with visions, with a life ahead.
Very theatric though. Feels like I've been told a story.
Things went wrong. Now his ambitions have turned to smiles, conserved in frames, still could be strong.
Yeah, so this is all 4-4, but our phrases are 5-3-4-4. So it makes the first half of the phrase sound a bit disjointed, even if the time signature is standard. I liked what they were going for there. I think they achieved it well. But I do think it was just a tad bit needlessly complex.
While the dusk is falling, alone, he whispers his goodnight, turning away when sleep is coming.
I chuckled there at the end because it seemed a little bit too melodramatic for it. Maybe when we get into the lyrics, it's going to be one of those situations where they really wanted to achieve something that was a bit beyond their reach. And maybe it could have been more impactful with that type of emotion, with a different execution, maybe with more years of experience. But it's not fair to necessarily compare them to that because, you know, they didn't have that experience. This was their debut album. And I think it's fine for what it is. I think it does bite off a little more than it can chew. And I think that final moment there is a really good showcasing of that. It felt a bit overly dramatic for what they had set up. I feel like they really wanted to go in that direction though, and I would love, see, this is like something up for contention. People already dislike remasters. I would love to hear more bands take a second pass on an older track of theirs. You know, you've written 8 albums since your first. You've been playing for 10, 15 years now. What would you do differently on an older track? Maybe not a more generic track. You know, you every band has those songs that fit more within their genre, but most bands also have that really ambitious one where they tried to punch a little above their weight. What would you do differently now with all of your years of experience? How would you recreate it? I would love to hear more bands do this, which is interesting because I would never do this myself. Everything I write is in the past. It's who I was at the time. I don't have any plans on revisiting something I've done in the past. So maybe it's a bit hypocritical of me in that perspective, but something like this, I feel like it has a lot of potential, and that's not to say it's bad in any way. I just really think that it could be more impactful in ways now that they have a lot of experience doing what they've done over the years, and to take another shot at it. However, one thing that I hope they wouldn't change that I really love is just the endearing late 90s, early 2000s virtual strings. There's something very clear about the way they sound. You're like, yeah, that's not a real string instrument. It's close. It's close enough to kind of fit, especially there at the end, really big moment. It's pushed into the background, out to the sides. A lot of the, you know, the two guitar lines, the bass line, all of the drumming stuff, you know, it overshadows it, and you really only get a piece of the sound of the instruments. They're not super clear, because they're covered up. And like that's enough. But when it was brought to the forefront, you're like, yeah, that's no, those aren't real strings. But there's something really endearing about it. I don't know if I just have nostalgia for that sound, you know, hearing a lot of it in the early 2000s. But I love it. And if they redid it, like, there's a part of me that's like, keep those early MIDI sounds, please. But yeah, I'm kind of curious what other people think about that. Should bands revisit their older stuff and make new versions of it? Not just remaster it, but rewrite it, rearrange it. Keep the same intensity. I mean, don't make an acoustic version of it, right? Try to achieve the same thing you were aiming for, but do it better this time around. Your writing chops are better, your performance chops are better. Maybe you would have changed up a guitar solo. Maybe you would have put an extra solo in there. Maybe you would have expanded the lyrics now that you're writing. Your the characterization of how you write is different. Your vocabulary is stronger. I don't know. Like I said, I think it's going to be a divisive topic, but I think it's going to yield some pretty cool conversation going on. Let me know your thoughts on it. All right. So I had mentioned early on that there are just there's a lot of toolboxes open on this track. Each of the instrumentalists are all showcasing a wide variety of skill sets within their instrument. The bass has driving rock bass lines. It also has some really funky stuff. It has syncopated jazzy lines. We have some nice walking bass line sections. They're really showcasing quite a few disciplines on the bass guitar. Our guitarist has little jazzy vampy sections as well as full-on shreddy metal sections. Our vocalist has a nice raw forward projected gritty clean that he utilizes, very hard rock style. but also has a more airy, whispery, vulnerable vocal style, and more of more theatrical, I think. Not necessarily any different from the rock style as far as timbre goes, but the placement is further to the back to get a wider sound on it instead of the more narrow forward placed voice. And yeah, again, just a lot of variety. The drummer, man, the drummer's all over the place. Dude has so many fills and patterns in so many different styles. It's fascinating. And just listening to all of this come together on this track, I think, is exceptionally fascinating. I don't know that every single section works back to back the way that they do. It is early prog metal in my ears, where the concepts of transition were not exactly as well explored as the concept of mashing things together. And I think it's really interesting that this early era of prog metal sort of defined what prog metal would become. A lot of modern prog metal follows in this vein. It's usually an exception to the rule when you find a band who is exceptionally interested in transitions. I mean, this style of music is still, you still hear it in bands like Between the Buried and Me today, in their latest albums. You hear it in Tesseract, in Periphery. I mean, everybody leading the djent movement. Metal has always had this sort of harsh transition focus, and I mean, this is a band that sort of runs with that. I think it's interesting pairing this, not intentionally, of course, but pairing this with Tame Impala earlier today, where I basically stated that the entire song is one idea that evolves throughout the course of the track. Every section is so closely tied to the one prior to it, even when we explore completely new ideas. And this is just such the opposite of it as far as transitions go. And for anybody who's new here, yeah, I don't make any judgments. There's no right or wrong way to craft a transition. I have a preference, sure, but you know, Pain of Salvation isn't doing it any worse than Tame Impala is. They're just doing it differently. But it is an interesting trend, and I do think that this era of prog metal did a lot to influence the bands who would come after it. And I think it's kind of a shame, again, just for my preference of transition style, that these bands who didn't have a lot of experience with composition yet and were doing these very cool combinations of sounds, but just, you know, roughly smashing them together, ended up influencing so many bands that even after years of composing, you're on your 8th, 9th, 10th album here, you're still doing these smash cuts because that's the style that you've excelled at, because that's how the earliest bands without a lot of experience ended up creating their music. And again, that's not to say that it's exclusively how prog metal handles their composition, but it is so dominant in the field. And you know, it kind of makes me think about metal as a whole. A lot of metal trends were written, not intentionally, of course. They didn't know that they were writing the blueprint for what everyone would be doing in the future. But a lot of the trends of the genre are written by amateurs, you know? People with no music training, with very little composition training, you know, just grab a guitar and play what sounds good. And I think it'd be really interesting if metal would be taken more seriously by the academic world, and how cool it would be to see a future of metal where, yes, there's still, you know, a large part of musicians still coming from that autodidactic world of classic metal, but really seeing a trend where more metal musicians have academic training, particularly in composition, I think, is where I'm most intrigued by that. You know, we definitely have more metal musicians coming from, you know, Berkeley, especially for some reason. Now that I think about it, a lot of prog metalists come from Berkeley. Why is that, like, the only place I've ever heard of people coming from? It is becoming more normal to go to school for music and come out and play in prog bands. But it's still not the still not super standard. It's very much the fringe element. Anyways, I'm way off topic. Let's get back onto Pain of Salvation. Where was I? Variety of sounds. Yes. So we kind of talked about how all the instruments have a variety of skills, but even compositionally, we hear a lot of skill in crafting a lot of sounds. We started off with some really funky, jazzy stuff, light and sparse, bass-led. I really enjoyed this part, and even cooler. I'd mentioned there's a lot of harsh transitions in here, and I think the transition here is still harsh, but we have a bit of foreshadowing and translation that I really enjoyed, is that the core melody in our opening funky part ended up getting put into the guitar as a stripped-down version that primarily focused on the key notes. And that eventually became the riff for our opening rock metal sound. Very cool way to sort of pass the baton on that one. But still, we start off with something really jazzy. We move into this light rock sound. We get some heavy, like hard rock, lighter, heavy metal. It's funny, heavy metal implies harshness to me, but heavy metal is one of the lightest metals. You know, heavy is contrasted with the extreme metals. What a way that the terms happened. And yeah, like I know, it's because heavy metal was heavy at the time. It's just not heavy anymore, so we need a heavier term for it. But I think it's funny. We have light rock and hard rock, but then heavy metal and extreme metal, and they both sound pretty gnarly, but heavy metal's so light nowadays. Yeah, we get into a heavier mode there. We get the nice grit. We got some driving guitar riffs. The drums go crazy. It's fascinating to listen to so many disciplines performed well, and not even just performed well, but composed well. You know, that's sort of what I want to highlight here. It isn't just that it's jazzy, it's kind of jazz in a lot of ways. I wouldn't say that it's would be something you might hear in a nightclub with a jazz band playing, but I think it's jazzy enough that I would call it jazz. And the same goes for the lighter rock stuff, the hard rock, the heavy metal. You know, everything is just performed so well. When you bring in the choirs and the strings, a lot of it is more atmospheric and textural, but still, it's about using the timbres when they think the timbre should be used best, and I agree with most of their decisions. I wouldn't say that the writing for the strings are particularly strong compared to their writing for their instruments, the guitars and the bass and the vocals, or sorry, and the drums. But it's still about having the patience and knowledge of when to use what instruments and what styles that helps with the pacing of the entire track. And it shows a lot of maturity there for a band who's just starting out. I think it does show a lot of maturity in the composition side of things. Man, I just thought about this topic I wanted to touch on. I don't remember what it is. The narrative. I don't normally pause my videos, but being that I've rambled so much already, I didn't want to take up more time just me saying, "Huh, what was it I was thinking of?" Yeah, the narrative though. I don't really have a strong read on the overall feeling of the song because it goes through so many moments and modes that it's difficult to pinpoint one specific emotion or a general cloud of emotions to it. It feels more like several scenes of a story in which each scene can have its own emotional weight. What I think the song does well, though, as I've already mentioned, is sort of pacing of it all. The song has peaks and valleys, and it kind of pulls you along in a very natural way between all of these, with escalating heights and escalating dips as well, where every low point is just a bit higher than the previous low point. This is just story writing 101, and I think it's very appropriate here given the theatric element going on in this track. I don't know if it is specifically a story being told, but it feels like that with all of the scene changes. And there's a very theatric element to several of these moments, especially I get from the vocalist. And all of this, of course, peaks about a minute, 2 minutes prior to the end of the track, when we hit just the highest point, and it's so layered, so complex. We bring back every instrument. There's counterpoint. Oh, I gotta bring up the metric stuff too, real quick. The meter is odd, but not. As I mentioned, it is 4-4, but we have the phrasing is 5 beats, 3 beats, 4 beats, 4 beats, which of course fits within 4 bars of 4-4. It's still 16 beats, but it feels odd and it creates tension and complexity in the rhythms, especially when you listen to the drums. They have some wild ideas at this part. It gets fairly complex, and it is just this world closing in, right? All the tension, all of the conflict is coming to a head, and it's about to erupt, and then the song fizzles out until we have just that final dramatic moment. I'm really excited to get into the lyrics to see if this is more of a story-based track, if it because it feels like a film to me, or feels like a short story. And I think they did an incredible job of taking me on this journey, creating tons of contrast throughout. I mean, this is honestly pretty good for prog rock. And I say pretty good. I don't want to say peak prog rock because I still feel like there's a lot of nuanced things here that come from inexperience. There's a lot of aspects to this that I don't think it can quite hang with some of the best prog rock and prog metal tracks I've heard, but it is ridiculously good for coming out the gates. They said, here's our first album, and we are swinging for the fences already. And I don't quite think they made that home run, but they came quite a bit closer than I think most bands do on their first album. And so I give them a pretty good. The last thing I wanted to bring up, though, is the meter. It is bonkers all over the place, and it's a varying effect, I think, is my opinion on it. There are sometimes it feels really good. The odd time signatures they bring in, the confusion that it can create, but there's other times where I feel like it's done for complexity's sake. Prog music at this time feels like it's pushing towards more of the compositional, which tends to be more harmonically and metrically complex, and less away from the earlier prog sound of sonically progressive, playing around with the way things sound, introducing new instruments, especially in the 70s. There's a lot of new technology showing up that they can play with. Synthesizers and stuff are coming out. And so progressive music then was more about introducing new sounds to the rock formula. And once we hit around this time, prog music, especially prog metal, began to push into let's use the same instruments, but write music that's more progressive. And for whatever reason it is, the metric components is what got focused on a lot. We do have some fun harmonic stuff in here, primarily in the funkier, jazzier sections, but for the most part, a lot of this takes place within a fairly standard metal realm of sound, chordally speaking. But they play around a lot with time signature all over the place. Right off the bat, I had mentioned that we have a 3 bars of 4 and a bar of 3 thing going on. So it's 15 beats rather than the full 16 you'd expect. There were some parts in the middle that were playing around with using 7 in places. They were playing around with quasi polymeter ideas, having phrases go over the line of bars, which is actually what we saw there at the end too, with the 5-3-4-4, probably overlaid on just 4 bars of 4-4. There's a lot of it. I caught quite a few sections I'm sure I missed just as many. When you put so many time signature changes in a track, I'm not going to get them all, but yeah, they're just all over the place, and it provides a feeling of consistent what would you even call it? Consistent changes to the heartbeat of the song. And to the heartbeat of the story, to a point where almost every section, or as I kind of feel them, every scene has its own pulse. And so it's not just about the emotional weight, but also about the rhythm of the section. Does it feel disjointed? Does it feel chaotic? And it certainly adds to the emotional weight of many of these sections of the track. All right, I'm going to hit some lyrics right here, and then we're going to wrap this one up. All right, so opening lines feel very appropriate for today. A September sun emerges through clouds, chasing across the sky. At least over here, we have mostly overcast, and the sun is finally deciding to peek out, but it's still not too bright. Jokes on the sun, though. We're supposed to have rain all throughout the rest of the day. That sun finally coming out is on borrowed time. Anyways, though, the song is about... Yeah, it's a funny segue on those opening lines. The song is about somebody who is feeling alone and feeling quite a lot of pain in their life. It says, thoughts are evoked behind detached eyes. Once he was a child with burning desires, with hopes and dreams of what was to come. So he's lost some faith, but still there are fires deep inside that he must drench to numb. This person has being inside him. He has goals and wants and dreams, and instead puts them out in order to feel numb. It mentions later on, once he was strong and filled with visions, with life ahead he set his aims. Then things went wrong. Now his ambitions have turned to smiles conserved in frames. He's no longer happy. We don't know what went wrong. The song never quite goes into the history. What was the moment that robbed him of his happiness, of his passion? But he doesn't. The idea of all the smiles have been conserved in frames. So he doesn't smile anymore. The only way you can see that is if you look at pictures. And this is just a person who has completely lost all passion and life. Now, what I've skipped over is that pretty much every other stanza here, when we don't hear about who he is and how he's feeling, is we hear about the people around him. The people around him are unable to see behind the creature that he seems to be. They don't see past his facade. They don't look further than surface level. And this is where the thesis comes in. It says, if we could try to share some of his wounds just for a while, but we're all just people passing by. Later on says that if we could try to ease some of his pain, but we are just people passing by. This is a person who needs help. And they're too numb, too scared, too whatever, to directly ask for it. And as a whole, we are very detached from those around us. And I kind of like that. The idea that we should reach out to those that we can help more often. Because we don't know what they're going through. Just even in general, not even reaching out, but just being nicer to people around us, I think is something that was certainly true in the 90s and is still true today. Though I feel at least in some capacity it is getting a little better in some ways. But I mean, also, we have the internet now. And that creates even more distance between people, especially as we begin to spend more and more time on it and less time around people. feel like the distance between peoples in general is expanding, even if the general way that we talk about things like mental health is a bit more positive now than it was in the 90s. One step forward, two steps backwards kind of thing, I suppose. Regardless, I feel like this message is still quite pertinent to today. Now, as for how I read the music, though, it being a story, like, I don't really get that from the lyrics. It actually feels very poetic to me, in that we sort of move through stages of this person, more so than exploring a series of events. And so I feel a little bit of a disconnect there. And because we had so many sections and I couldn't get too strong of a read on the emotional aspect of it, which could just be first time reaction thing, you know, maybe you listen to it a few times and you begin to ingest it a bit better, begin to figure out what it's doing. Maybe it does become a bit more clear what its emotional resonance is, but without really being able to get that right here, it does end up being a song with the lyrics feel a bit divorced from the music for me. The music is proggy, the lyrics themselves are a bit more progressive, but they don't line up in ways that are thematically cohesive, which, as usual, is fine. There's no right way to write a track, and this is quite effective. It's a good song, it's a good set of lyrics. They don't necessarily have to line up to be excellent. Those are my thoughts on Pain of Salvation's People Passing By. I gotta do a little stretch there. Hip starting to hurt. I know why people sit down to do their reactions. I just feel so constrained. Like, I don't feel like I can move my body when I'm sitting in a chair. If y'all have seen me sitting for the few live streams that I have, I just feel like I'm less active, less mobile. So I like the freedom of standing up, and that's why I stand up for my reactions. But I'll tell you what, man, can be a bit sore on the joints just standing in place for hours. Anyways, what was I saying? Oh yeah, those are my thoughts. Let me know your thoughts on this track. Your perspectives, comments, angles, opinions, whatever. And you know, I asked some questions earlier in the video about some things that weren't specifically particular to Pain of Salvation, if you want to answer any of those questions as well. Above the comment section in the description box, you'll find a link to Linktree. You can find links to my music, ways to support the channel, a link to the Discord server, and so much more. Above that, if you could, like, subscribe, and ring the bell. I greatly appreciate all three of them. All right, that wraps it up for today. I'll be back tomorrow, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 p.m. UTC, as usual. I don't know what I was thinking when I flipped this around, but whatever. Until next time, y'all remember to be critical, not cynical, and have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.